maybe still kind of got it wrong. Anyway, just to mention, Dini briefly spoke, and what she didn't mention was that she's one of the volunteers there that spent every single night from 11 o'clock when we were all sleeping till 5 in the morning, 11 o'clock at night till 5 in the morning, on site, at the site, and then still had a day job and is still here this morning. I mean, what a perfect morning to stay in bed. You've been on that site after a week of doing it, and it's Mother's Day. My goodness, surely I deserve a day off. Just want us to also, don't clap or anything, she'll be embarrassed, but just to honor the sacrifice of so many. She's one of a number of volunteers, but also to thank you for your contribution financially. I want to say tens of thousands. It's definitely more than 10,000 that came in from the body when we put out that message. And so a lot of that money has gone straight into providing what is needed, and we will continue to do so. And also for the guys that brought and dropped off stuff, we are really, really grateful. All right, today, as you know, we're going to continue with our identity series. I trust you have your books with you. You will be on page 10 in your identity book, page 10. It should be empty at the moment because you're supposed to take notes. Okay. Mine is still empty because I've got plenty of notes. But there it is, page 10. And you know, the identity series is part of our bigger love series, as you know, which speaks about loving God and loving one another. But the identity part, this part, really helps us with loving ourselves, getting our identity right in Him, and therefore being able to love ourselves. And if we can love ourselves, we can actually love others. Because the command is, love others like you love yourself, which is quite difficult when you don't really like or love yourself. And so this identity course is really, really helpful. It can be, especially today, can be simply informational, but it can also be truly transformational. I really believe that today's message, like probably every other one, can be completely transformational if we allow the Holy Spirit to speak to us. We've heard a number of people during these couple of weeks giving testimonies of how they're starting to see themselves differently and how that changes them, how the change in them changes their feeling towards God and towards others as they start to align their thinking with God's thinking about them. You see, it's always this identity gap, closing the identity gap, the gap between how God sees us and how we see ourselves. You might remember we drew those circles. God sees us like this. We see ourselves like this. And there's a bit of an overlap. And we're trying to, sorry, I've got too many fingers. And we're trying to, that's better. We're trying to get, no, that's also not going to work, them to overlap. Just imagine the whiteboard. We're trying to get these circles to overlap more and more and more so that what I believe about myself comes into line with what God believes about me. What I say about myself comes in line with what He says about me. So that I can actually see myself as heaven sees me. So each week, we trust that we'll start to think differently about ourselves and to experience that, the way we think differently, that turns into the way that we will actually start acting and living differently. Our thinking determines our actions, our habits, and our behaviors. What we believe inside is what we will eventually live out outside. Our thinking determines our actions, habits, and behavior. What we believe inside, we will live out outside. Today's message, I think, can be very challenging. Not because I'm trying to make it challenging, just because it really kind of challenged me. Our topic today is, I am a saint. A saint. I am a saint. He is my Savior. And I don't know about you, but because I'm standing here, it's supposed to roll off the tongue easily because I'm the one having to say it. But most of you know me, And I know me very well. We're coming to that part. Thank you, John. So you can start off the top of your notes, page 10. I'm a saint. He is my savior. So one of the statements that you'll find in the daily reading for the week is that not only does God love me, he also likes me. And that's awesome. You see, most of us, it's Mother's Day, and so most of us have children. And so we always love them. But you know, sometimes, perhaps for some out there, they don't always like their kids at that specific point. Just at that moment. Just think back, you're in church. You're surrounded by believers. It's okay to be honest. Just think of maybe the teens or whatever, you know. I can just see David smiling at the back there. Where's his poor parents? Welcome. So good to see you, David. And other David. And Sharon. And everyone else. We're all special, just like everybody else. Okay. Back to the fact that, sometimes we don't really like what they're doing. Thing is, I know that Jesus loves me. How do I know this? Because of this. Yeah, because the Bible tells you so, yeah? Jesus loves me. They say, no. Because the Bible tells me so. But the thing that he also likes me. He loves me and he likes me. Even though he doesn't agree with my behavior at some time, sometimes. An amazing thing is, why is that? That's because I'm a saint. Not look at me, think about yourself. Say that in your own. Actually, I'm going to get you to say that in a moment. The reason is that I'm a saint. So won't you turn to the person next to you and say to him or her that you're a saint. I am a saint. Okay? It's actually in my notes to say, now do it without laughing or without the yeah, right smile. Okay? So do it again. I'm a saint. I see these wonderful leaders in the front have already skipped to the next point. Now please tell them that they're a saint too. I'm a saint, but you're also a saint.
You're a saint.
Yes. It's not always that easy to declare yourself a saint, is it? Again, because you know you. Who knows what is required to be canonized? Now, yes, exactly. So canonized is not that act when they put you in the cannon and they shoot you across the circus tent. Okay, that's not to be canonized. It's actually when the church, normally the Catholic Church, declares you a saint. Okay, that's what it means. So I probably have a better chance to be shot across the stadium or the tent. But in any event, these are the four qualifications. Firstly, you have to be dead for at least 5 years. So that's kind of problematic, okay? First thing, you have to be dead for at least 5 years. Secondly, they then investigate your life to see if there's evidence of a life well lived, where there's righteousness, virtue, and holiness. Thirdly, they go wider with their investigation, and they look at your influence on others. Remember, this is done at least 5 years after your death. So now they look at your influence on others. What legacy did you leave behind at least 5 years, probably 50 years later on? And lastly, they require at least 2 miracles that can be attributed to you as a person directly, while still alive. Okay, so just those four things to be canonized. Now, it's a rather tall order. And suddenly, we all feel less saintly. We've just declared ourselves to be saints, and now we hear this. So we've heard of St. Peter and St. Paul and St. James and St. Bernard, although I think that's a dog. But I'm not sure. In any event. But
sent me. It just doesn't. Any event, you see, once again, immediately, there's evidence of the identity gap. There's the truth of God's word and the way that we kind of giggle about that. Because we think, really? Sent me? So let's look at what the word of God says. My opinion is as irrelevant as your opinion. What does the Bible say? Ephesians 1, verse 1, please. Obviously, Paul writing a letter to the believers in Ephesus. And he says, Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, to the saints in Ephesus, the faithful in Christ Jesus. So when they opened and read that letter, it didn't mean, okay, well, the rest of you can now leave. It's only for these five. It was actually written to all of the believers in Ephesus. It's to every single believer. It's to the church in Ephesus, the saints, the believers, all of those who have placed their faith in Christ Jesus. Now, some of them would have been very new Christians, very new believers. They would have maybe been saved a week or less. Some of them maybe longer. Paul spent quite a number of years there. He spent 3 years there, and this obviously the letter came much later. So there might have been some very mature Christians as well. But the letter is addressed to them all. Each and every believer, each and every follower of Christ is called a saint by Paul. It doesn't matter how immature or how mature they are in their walk. The Bible refers to you, just like to them, as a saint. You see, you and I become saints the moment that we receive Christ Jesus as our Savior. That is the biblical truth of the matter. The Bible refers to us, to me and you, as saints, and the moment that we receive Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. And yet, it's probably easier to say about ourselves, well, I'm no saint, but. Thing is, we still think that saint, or the word saint, refers to those that are absolutely perfect, that have it absolutely all together, that are living a perfect and sinless life. And so maybe to help us, we should just continue to read from that same letter. So Ephesians, the same letter, Ephesians chapter 4, from verse 25 to 31. Ephesians 4, 25 to 31. Same letter addressed to the same people, to the same saints, he writes to them. Therefore, each one of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to his neighbor, for we are all members of one body. In your anger, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down while you are still angry, and do not give the devil a foothold. He who has been stealing must steal no longer, but must work doing something useful with his hands, that he may have something to share with those in need. Do not let any unwholesome talk come from your mouth, but only what is helpful for building up others according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with whom you are sealed for the day of redemption. Get rid of all bitterness, rage, anger, brawling, slander, along with every form of malice. So it would be obvious that this stuff was still there, prevalent among the saints. This letter was written to them. Suddenly, these saints are not perfect like we thought. Suddenly, these saints seem like a work in progress, don't they? And that's the point, you see, exactly. We are all a work in progress, just as they were. And we are therefore called saints, just as they were. We are all still a work in progress, just like they were. But we are all called saints, just like they were. Won't you draw in your notebook that kind of lifeline, what did I call it? A life spectrum in your identity book. Can you see it? I trust you can. It has a dot and a line with an arrow, a cross, and a rest in peace tombstone. Okay, I could walk. Well, can't really walk. I'm stuck. But it's there for me to point it out It's still there. Then, will you leave about five lines open underneath that? Because you're going to be filling in some stuff underneath that. It's actually part of my notes too. And I've got all my goodies there and my drawing. Very neat. And obviously, beautifully highlighted and pink and yellow and all sorts. So, 4 points that you have there. Firstly, the starting point, the little bean. In your case, there's only one, not three. So that's the day that you are born. That's the simple part. Your physical birth on the earth. Secondly, the cross. That's when you have your intervention with the cross of Jesus. The day that you are reborn, the day of your salvation, receiving Jesus Christ as both Lord and Savior. The tombstone obviously represents the day that you pass away and that you exchange this life for the next. And the line that continues, the little arrow that continues, points to, represents eternity that awaits each and every one of us, knowing that this earth is not our home, that death is not the end for us. So now we can continue and we can actually divide it into four sections. The first part is my BC life. That's between my start and the cross. Okay, that first section. The BC life. Not before COVID, before Christ. That part of your life. Secondly, then, when we get to the cross, the moment of your salvation, the moment of your spiritual rebirth. So you can start writing some of these things underneath there. Salvation, spiritual rebirth, being adopted. I have a new identity, a new identity at that moment. The moment that I become a saint, perfect, blameless, because I've been fully redeemed by the blood of Christ, which means that when the Father looks at me, he sees Christ, because I am hidden in Christ, and therefore he sees me as perfect, as saint. Number three. The next part is the kind of between the cross and the tombstone. We'll fit in a moment. We're going to draw a little maniki there, or a little froki. You can put yourself in there. This process of life, of being transformed into Christ-likeness, the process of learning new ways. So it's the first one was my new identity, but this is the process of new ways, receiving a new set of values. And the wonderful thing is we're not left to figure this out by ourselves. How do I do this? How do I walk this walk? Jesus promised that he would give us a helper. So in John chapter 14, verse 16 to 18, it says, "And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another counselor to be with you forever, the Spirit of Truth. The world cannot accept him because they neither see him nor know him. But you know him, for he lives within you, and he will be with you. I will not leave you as orphans." This whole course is about moving from an orphan to having identity. Today, the identity of a saint. So the indwelling Spirit of God is at work to transform us into holiness, sanctification, the process of being made holy. And fourthly then, number four, the rest in peace part, the promotion into the next life, where we'll be with Christ for all eternity. A new body, a new identity, a new set of ways, of values, and then a new body. Perfect, healthy, pain-free, sinless, being with Christ for all eternity. Fully holy in every way. The future that awaits every single believer. So we can also the following down. We can also say that at the moment of salvation, I am justified. And then during my Christian life, during my walk part between the cross and the grave, I am being sanctified. The moment of salvation is justification in that moment, perfect, but also a continuing process, being sanctified. And the moment that I leave this earth to be with Jesus is to be glorified. So, justified, sanctified, glorified. Now,
I would like you to draw yourself somewhere along that line. I think for most it would be somewhere between the cross and the tombstone. I'm trusting that is true for everyone. I don't know why there's fresh giggles. But I trust that you're somewhere on that spectrum. If you're not between the cross and the tombstone, I'd love to have a chat with you afterwards. It will be a very friendly chat, I promise it's not. Okay. And so I want us to do three things. Remember now, as saints this morning, this is where it becomes real. As saints, we stand there, wherever you've plotted yourself, and you don't have to make your little manicure folky turn around, but just imagine him or her looking backwards. Look back with gratitude and thanksgiving, an incredible humility. For me, definitely. Gratitude, thanksgiving, and incredibly humble. Giving thanks to God that he kept you up to this point, especially during the BC part of life. I don't know about you, but I think it's possibly true for most of us. I think most of us can think of a moment during that BC part where we should have been killed. We should have been dead in that moment. Something happened. I shouldn't have walked away from that, thinking back. I definitely can. So we're grateful for our adoption, grateful for our new identity, grateful that I'm justified, grateful that I'm a saint. 2 Corinthians 9, verse 15, short, powerful verse says the following: thanks be to God for his incredible gift. Amen. And then also, as we stand there, your little maniki, on that line, the second thing we do is we look around us at the here and the now. Remember, in that portion, it's the sanctification portion. And so Ephesians 4, 22 to 24 really puts it well. It says that you were taught with regard to your former way of life to put off your old self, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires, to be made new in the attitudes of your minds, and to put on the new self, created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. To put off the old self, to put on the new self, to be created like God in true righteousness and holiness. 2 Corinthians 5, 17, we know well, it says, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old is gone, the new has come. Anyone is in Christ, he's a new creation. The old has come, the new has gone. The other way around. Old is gone, new has come. Thirdly, your maniki looks forward. Looks forward with great hope. With hope and excitement for the future that God still has for us while on this earth and beyond. Do we realize that we speak of eternal life, and we sometimes think of eternal life after death? Fact is that if we belong to Christ, we have eternal life right now. Even though you switch from one dimension to the other, you have eternal life. It's not going to start one day when you die. It has already started in Christ. And so, Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2, well known. We fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and the perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him, looking forward, the joy set before him, endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of God the Father. The amazing thing is that which we might read over, this for the joy set before him, we, the saints, we are the joy that was set before him. That which kept him through that process was the joy of these faces and the thousands upon 10,000 that we read of in Revelation. That was the joy. Your face is part of the joy that was set before him. that carried him through the process of the cross and the crucifixion. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 9. No eye has seen, no ears heard, no mind has conceived what God has in store for them, what God has prepared for those who love him. Incredible things that God has in store for those who love him. And once again, we don't have to wait for heaven to experience the incredible joys of what he has prepared for us. So coming into land, it would seem that I'm a saint. And so are you. We might not look like or feel like a saint always. We might definitely not act like a saint always. But it does not affect how heaven sees us. Heaven sees us as saints. Part of my new identity is to align my thinking with heaven so that I can believe what God says and what God sees in me. Part of my new identity this morning is that I will see myself as a saint to align my thinking with heaven's thinking, to believe what God says and what God believes about me. Which means we have to start looking at ourselves through heaven's eyes. Can we have that video clip?
If you, since after Basson's message, believe that you are a saint, then please stand. And I'm going to pray for us. Father God, I thank you that you, in your divine plan for mankind, for everyone who believes in the name of Jesus, you planned and designed and declared that we would be saints in your eyes. And Father God, as hard as that is for us to believe in our own heads and in our the history of our lives, Lord, I pray that this morning that you will replace that with a new value system. Lord, that we will see the value that we have in you because of who you are. And Father God, that we will value the things that you value because of who you are, because of who Jesus is. So this morning I want to pray for each one of us that we will see the value of our lives through heaven's eyes and because of who Jesus is. And that because of that, we will value and love and fight for and believe for the things that are on the Father's heart. That's what I really want to pray for each one of us. We are saints. And because we are saints, we have a new value system. And because we have a new value system, we see ourselves with different value. And because we see ourselves with different value, we value things differently. And we value the things of the Father and the things that are on his heart for us. In Jesus' name, amen. So I want to end the meeting, but I'd love to pray for you specifically this morning. There were a few words that came through. Just if you felt like you have lost your value, or you've just been disregarded or forgotten about, or that you need the support of the Father just to come and sing over you and rejoice over you again. We'd love to pray.